welcome to the eighth lecture in the Understanding Anger series, the eighth and penultimate lecture. Next lecture will be about Thomas Aquinas, so it'll bring together some of these other thinkers that we've been looking at. What we're doing in this one is looking at early Christian thinkers, so it's kind of a mixed bag. There's no one single theme uniting it, other than they are Christian thinkers. They are within, you know, this growing movement, which, you know, doesn't take really solid, you know, rigid, determinate form until, you know, some time has passed. And some of these guys are actually arguing with each other, as we're going to see. So it's quite interesting. Some of this has philosophical perspectives. A lot of these people thought of themselves as Christian philosophers, and we'll see why in a bit. But it's clearly in a religious context or a theological context. Now, we don't have an awful lot of books that are specifically about anger until later on, but we have all these scattered discussions and teachings and depictions of anger in the Christian scriptures, in the Gospels and the letters. And these provide some really interesting touch points for Christian thinking. That's all right. The time period that we're looking at begins in the 2nd century AD, and we're going to like the 5th century, mostly the 4th and 5th century thinkers that we're looking at, in part because there's not an awful lot of systematic discussion of this sort of stuff until later on. Well, that happens.
This is sort of, it's a game on this one.
She's trying to end it.
Oh, God.
I do the same thing. Sometimes something happens and I can't figure out how to do it.
Well, so we're gonna do our usual like hour or so of presentation, and then we'll do half an hour of Q&A, although it might, you know, bleed over as we're going through it. So the main topics for this talk are, I want to talk first about the sources for Christian thought. We, you know, in our own context today, we often think of Christians, because many Christians are like this, as you might say the people of one book, right, the Bible. Some of these people are writing in times when the canon is a bit more fluid, but none of them are writing just making reference in a proof text way to Scripture. That was something that's relatively rare until just a few centuries ago. You can find some people doing that, but for the most part, there's a lot more going into Christian thought than just Scripture. So we're going to look at these two early Christian thinkers, really early, Tertullian and Lactantius. Lactantius actually has a treatise on the anger of God, which is quite interesting, so he's going to be very useful. And then I was going to touch on a lot of later Christian thinkers. I think I was a bit ambitious in how I described what I was going to do. And I was going to do Jerome and Evagrius and all that. And then when I thought about how much time we've actually got and how much material I can build into it, I decided, let's just do three later guys, all of whom are major Christian thinkers, very influential. Augustine of Hippo in the West. John Chrysostom, equally as important as Augustine in the East, and then finally John Cassian, the great monastic writer who's going to influence the Benedictines and everybody else coming after. So when we think about sources of Christian thought, these early Christian thinkers, it's important to remember that they are within the ancient world. This is before the barbarian invasions, although Augustine does get to see Rome fall. This is before the Dark Ages, which were shorter than we actually think, you know, looking at it from an Enlightenment perspective. But did exist. There was a period of decline. This is before that. So all of these thinkers are part of this ancient Greek and Roman culture and civilization. Christianity itself starts in an area centered by Roman-occupied Judea, and then it spreads out quite a bit. And even Judea itself is a pretty diverse area. There's a lot of stuff going on there. Of course, you know, what makes it Christianity as a movement is there's this key figure of Jesus viewed as the Christ, as the Messiah. And there's a lot of discussion about what exactly that means among the early Christians, but eventually they settle on, among other things, he's God. And, you know, there's encounters with him. He gives some teachings. There's narratives about what took place. And he leaves a way of life and a community behind. Then there's this period of writing new scriptures involved. And, you know, there's a continuity. We often think of, you know, Old Testament and New Testament. It's important to remember that this Jesus guy was himself, you know, reading from the scrolls in the synagogues. He was teaching in these, referring to Isaiah or, you know, other texts as well. And the early Christians would make sense out of what was happening in this guy's life by reference to those older scriptures. But new scriptures come in as well, including new forms of writing. The Gospels are really a new type of genre of literature. There's letters, a whole bunch of letters circulating around, you know, many of which make it into the canon, some of which don't. Acts, you know, sort of historical records of what's supposed to have been taking place with this growing community. And then there's, you know, of course, the book of Revelation. So I'm not really going to talk much about that because that doesn't bear much upon that, nor does it play an important role in these early thinkers' ideas about anger. They don't have a lot of commentaries on Revelation. They're more interested in commenting on the Sermon on the Mount, you know, or the Gospel of John, what's going on in this stuff. So scriptures are a major source for thinking. Another key source is the practical experiences involved in living out a Christian life. You know, they're figuring this out as they go along. In conversions and persecutions, which end up happening, in how to make sense out of the community. Not everybody gets along in any community. Those sort of things come up in Christian communities as well. In addressing polemics, people, you know, once Christianity comes on the scene as sort of a live option and an intellectual force, there's other people in the culture that are saying, this is bad stuff. Don't be like those, you know, those crazy Christians. Some of them had pretty good contact with the Christians and could you know, target the attacks relatively closely. Some of them, it was just sort of, you know, sort of like the equivalent of somebody who knows nothing about Islam today writing about them terrorists, you know. There was some of that going on as well. So, you know, a good example would be...
wasn't there a lot of dissent and economic failure at this time when the...
In Greece, in ancient Greece and Rome?
So that Christianity, I mean, the people would turn to Christianity.
That's not really a major reason why people turned to it. No, it was, I mean, there was a lot of attraction by looking at their way of life and their brotherly love for each other, you know, philia. But the explanation of people largely turned to Christianity because of... you know, he was providing them economic benefits. There's really nothing to that. That was sort of, those sorts of explanations were quite popular in the Enlightenment for trying to make sense out of why, you know, people would be attracted to this crazy religion. But we don't see an awful lot of that in the actual literary and historical sources. There's a wide range of reasons why people were attracted to Christianity. And there's a lot of... the polemics against it are coming from all different quarters, too. You know, some people are like, look, you know, this is essentially a bunch of low-class people. You don't want to be like them, you know. But then there were upper-class people who became Christians, and then that polemic doesn't work quite so well, you know. There are others. Augustine writes the City of God to try to respond to these pagan polemics that Christianity is sapping the moral fiber of Rome. And laying us open to you know, losing to the barbarians. And so he writes a book to try to respond to those sorts of criticisms. A lot of these Christians were very well educated, the ones that we're looking at, in the dominant culture. Many of them held important intellectual roles. You know, Augustine, for example, was a teacher of rhetoric who had quite a lot of success. before he decided he wanted to leave that behind. Most of them were very conversant with the literature of the ancient world, the poetry, the drama, the other religious literature. They were conversant with the techniques of reading, like allegorical reading, which didn't begin with just Christianity or Paul, but the Stoics were already practicing with respect to stories in Homer. There's a lot of intellectual, you know, cross-fermentation taking place here. Go ahead.
I was thinking about this at home before I got it. Were, are we talking, who, I guess I had this vision
yeah.
It started, of sort of less educated people. Now you're, and so
yeah.
I was trying to get a sense of the timing and who was doing all this development.
Well, there's a whole range. So there's no one single person or type of person. It's all centered around, ultimately, this
Christ figure?
Yeah. But he's being understood in many different ways. And many of the people, even in the early church, Paul was incredibly well-educated, both in a Hebrew tradition and in the Greek tradition. Matthew was a tax collector. He was literate. He would have been able to keep accounts. Some of them were fishermen and things like that. Very early on, there's people who have a lot of very strong intellectual backgrounds involved in the movement. And the people that we're reading here, these are the particularly literate ones. And it was felt that, you know, within the early church, there's scripture, and then there's also this sort of ongoing tradition that is of equal weight in trying to figure things out and trying to make sense of things. And that's these great thinkers, like Augustine, for example, who you would read and consult if you want to understand what's going on. Now, Augustine himself is not just saying that intellectual life is only important. He, in the On Christian Doctrine, will say there's old ladies out there who've never read a book in their life, and they know way more about the meaning of faith, hope, and charity than these bishops do, because they've actually lived it. So there's an experiential function. But these aren't felt to be in opposition with each other. A lot of the pictures that we have of early Christians are kind of caricatures. Now, that's not to say that everybody was, reading, involved in, great intellectual discussions. There are a lot of ordinary people who are, part of the movement as well. And probably for them, the rituals were more important or experiencing the way of life together. By contrast to the rest of society, where it was kind of dog-eat-dog, people didn't seem to care too much about each other. But, these people are very well-educated. Many of them are conversant with the major schools of antiquity that we've looked at so far, like, Plato, Aristotle, the Stoics, the Epicureans. It's very difficult to distinguish the religious from the cultural or the philosophical when we actually look at their texts. They're all kind of mixed in together because that's the way it really works for for anybody who has a strong religious faith and also is doing philosophy. You can't draw a neat dividing line, except in very artificial ways, between the two. So let's talk about the first guy, who's Tertullian. Tertullian is not a saint, in part because he ends up embracing a heresy later in his life, the Montanist heresy. So he's considered kind of suspect. But he's also this very important early theological figure, especially in the Western Church. He's seen as the first great Western theologian. And he was raised in Carthage, in Africa. He might have been a lawyer. There's back and forth, discussions about that in scholarship. He might have been a priest. He himself, here's a little historical irony, he himself spent a lot of his writings arguing against heresies, and what a heresy means, we should probably spend a little bit of time on that, comes from the Greek word heresis, which means choice.
Trust.
Or choice.
Trust?
Choice.
Oh, choice.
Choice as in like choosing one way or another way. Not just like, do I choose yellow paper or white paper, but like, do I choose to interpret everything in this way or in this way? And choices usually involve picking one thing and excluding other things. And early heresies within the church were generally not, you know, these sort of movements of the persecuted, and the Orthodox Christians were just being mean to them or something like that. It's usually the other way around. Usually the heretics were the ones who were saying, well, all the rest of you have got it wrong. We're going to take charge. You're not really part of Christianity. We're the ones who've got it entirely right. And a lot of these issues are sort of forced issues because of that. So, you know, Orthodoxy is not something that develops like right out of the gate. It's something that develops in part in response to these heresies. Now, Tertullian, like I said, the irony is Tertullian himself becomes a heretic. He lapses into this Montanist heresy, which we can talk about later on. It doesn't really play a role here. Now, he wrote two texts that are interesting when we're thinking about anger. Neither one of them are talking about anger systematically. They're just touching on it. But he does have something interesting in this book on the soul. And he, like many of the other ancient Christian writers, are relying upon the conception of the human person, the soul, the personality, that's very influenced by Platonism. So remember the three parts to the soul, the rational part, the appetites, and then this middle irascible or thumotic part. He accepts that, as do many of the other thinkers, and he's got some interesting discussions about that. Plato, he says, thought only the rational part derived from God. So a lot of early Christians then, you know, if they accepted that idea, they would say, well, what about these other parts, like our bodily desires? Well, those are from the devil. What about our you know, part that gets angry? Obviously from the devil, because it's irrational, you know. And Tertullian is saying, well, don't be so quick about that. Here's why. He gives a couple different examples. What about this Jesus Christ guy, right? He was rational, clearly. You know, he provides a doctrine about things. You should do things because of this reason. He's, you know, showing prudence in certain respects. Maybe not so much in giving Judas the, you know, purse strings, but in other things. But he says, Christ had a rational element by which he taught, by which he discoursed, by which he prepared the way for salvation. But there was also indignation or anger in him by which he inveighed against the scribes and the Pharisees. And there was also a principle of desire in him by which he earnestly desired to eat the Passover with his disciples. So if we don't want to say that Jesus himself contained things that were of the devil or irrational, we can't just dismiss these parts, he says. In our own cases, the irascible and concupiscible elements of our soul must not invariably be put to the account of the irrational. It's whether they're just sort of left to their own devices that determines whether they're irrational, because they can also listen to reason. This is what Plato was saying in his own works, right? And then he says another thing that's interesting. God also is angry with perfect reason with those who deserve his wrath. This is a theme that we're going to see Lactantius work with. And then Paul's supposed to be a pretty good guy, right? Paul concedes that he gets angry. But then Tertullian says, when he says we were formerly the children of wrath, what he's talking about there is not just getting angry. He's talking about an irrational irascibility, not that it proceeds from the nature which is the production of God, not that's built into our fabric, but our fallen nature, that which is with the devil brought in. So anger can work two different ways. Anger could be something, you know, before we were talking about anger being good and being bad, here it's a theological context. Anger could be of the devil, but it also could be of God. It could be built into our natures, the way God created us. It could be what was demonstrated to us by the example of Christ. So this allows him to, you know, make a distinction between these. Now, he doesn't actually say, here's the way to tell them apart or anything like that. That's what we'd probably want, right? But he doesn't do that there. He does have a book called On Patience, and there he considers this virtue that's very important in Christianity. Patience is putting up, I'm going to say it in a very crude term, patience is putting up with other people's BS.
Yes.
You know, it's not just like waiting around for an indefinite amount of time. It's putting up with the crap that the world and everybody else inflicts on you, and not losing your temper or becoming bitter or all these things. And for the early Christians, this was viewed as very important. And they also thought God kind of shows this because he puts up with all of our nonsense for a long time, right? So he talks specifically about revenge, and he says that revenge is to be avoided because what happens is you just double the wickedness that's been done. It seems to the person who's engaging in it as if they're setting things right, and it feels good to them, it consoles their pain. But from the perspective of God, all it's really doing is adding more evil. Instead of one person being subject to judgment for being a jerk, now two people are.
Consumes your energy and emotions.
There's another part as well. And then he brings up this thing that you're going to see a lot of the Christian thinkers struggling with. Vengeance is to be left to God alone. This judge not lest you be judged, he says, isn't so much about being judgmental. It has to do with patience. Because when you're taking revenge, you're engaging in an act of imposing a judgment upon somebody. So that's really all Tertullian has to tell us. If we go to Lactantius, now we're talking about somebody in the 3rd century. He writes a whole book on the anger of God. And he was a teacher of rhetoric. He was an advisor to the first Christian Roman emperor, Constantine, tutor to his son. He's often called the Christian Cicero by Renaissance humanists who liked his prose style. And he shows himself, if you read his works, I gave you that little selection in the newsletter. He knows all these philosophers. He quotes them. He brings them up. He's orienting this work particularly against the Epicureans and the Stoics, who he think not only get things about God wrong, but things about anger wrong. And he partially endorses the Aristotelian position, just partially though. So he distinguishes 4 possible positions about emotion in God. And he says, one is God doesn't feel any sort of kindness or anger towards human beings. That's what the Epicureans think. The gods don't have anything to do with human beings. That's why the gods are, blessed, because you guys know that expression that's circulating around, not my circus, not my monkeys. That's what the gods do, right? They're smart. They stay away from human affairs. Another one would be that God feels and exhibits kindness, but not anger towards human beings. And that's what the Stoics said. And then he said something really interesting. He says, here's another position. God feels and exhibits anger, but not kindness towards human beings. And he says, nobody teaches this. This is not a position that any, person to be taken seriously actually holds. The idea of a primarily vengeful God, that's not there in Lactantius, in the book on divine anger. And then he says another possibility is that God feels both anger and kindness towards us. And that's what he's saying is the Christian perspective. So against the Epicureans, what he says is a few things. He says, how can there be happiness or joy in a God that doesn't do anything? When we're involved in anger and when we're involved in showing kindness, we're at least active. But this idea of the gods is detached from everything and somehow blissful, that really doesn't make sense when you get down to it. And then he also says, if you take away anger and kindness as things that God can feel, you're also taking away all the other emotions. Because the affections, as he says, have one system and one motion. So he thinks the Epicureans are wrong in their view about the gods and anger. Now, everybody thought the Epicureans were wrong except for the Epicureans. So that's pretty, that's sort of like shooting fish in a barrel, right? The Stoics were taken much more seriously. And early Christianity has this, you might say, love-hate relationship with Stoicism. They draw a lot of stuff out of Stoic practices. The examination of conscience at nighttime, that's a Stoic practice before it's a Christian practice. There were a lot of things that they were willing to draw on. But here's one of the dividing lines. So he says, if you think about the Stoic position, it's that God doesn't get angry, and why not? Not because God couldn't feel emotion, but because anger presupposes injury and a smallness of mind. So anger for the Stoics is something that's always pathological. It's also unbecoming to a man, so it's even more unbecoming to God. If we're going to say it looks bad in human beings, it looks worse in God. Then he says, here's the problem. If God is not angry with the impious and the unrighteous, it's clear he doesn't love the pious and the righteous. An opposite matters, he says, it's necessary to be moved to both sides or to neither. He who loves the good also hates the wicked, and he who does not hate the wicked does not love the good. So he's saying there's something, we might not accept this idea, but here's the idea. There's something about, you know, the very orientation towards goodness that involves its contrast with evil. And if you love the good, you also should have a negative response towards the evil. So then he asks, well, what's God's anger like? You know, is it like human anger? He says, well, no. God is moved to favor when just things are done and to anger when unjust things are done. And so the Epicureans, he gives them a chance to respond. And they say, God must have fear and desire then and other affections arising from human weakness. You remember, Epicurus began his principal doctrines by saying the gods don't feel anger or partiality towards human beings. Why? Because those are signs of weakness. To be angry means somebody can make you angry, right? To feel favor is also a sign of weakness for them as well. And Lactantius' response is anger doesn't have to lead to these other emotions. For human beings, it often does, but it doesn't have to in God. In fact, anger even in human beings tends to drive out fear. You know, we do stupid things when we're angry because we lack our sense of fear, like getting in a bar fight or, you know, telling the boss to shove it or stuff like that. The fuller response that he has is God does not feel anger as a vicious emotion, as a bad emotion. When he feels anger, what anger he feels is actually the sort of thing that he ought to feel. And he says further, God is indeed angry because he's kind. Now, how does that make sense? Well, he's not being angry and kind at the same person. That will come about later in some Christian thinkers. But Lactantius is saying, God gets angry because he sees injustice taking place. And this is a common Old Testament theme as well. It's not just, look, if you don't obey me, I'm going to rain fire and brimstone down on you dirty people. It's also, I don't like what you're doing to the poor, to the oppressed, to the vulnerable, and I am angry at you rich, powerful people for the way that you're behaving, because you're not supposed to be behaving like that. You're supposed to be taking care of the vulnerable, right?
And that's what our new Pope is more or less saying.
Yeah,
saying that pretty steadily.
He's very good on message with that. I see that what he's doing largely in continuity with the last two as well. They were saying the same stuff. This one's getting a lot more airtime and saying it more strongly than they were. But that's a consistent message that God doesn't like people treating other people like crap. You know, I mean, this is going way back. This is Old Testament stuff. You know, Book of Amos. You know, these prophets. They're saying, you know, you seem to be doing good, you kings, but you better produce social justice. And if you don't, there's going to be a reckoning.
It seems more like judgment than anger. I mean.
Oh, yeah. Okay. So.
Doesn't seem so emotional as it does.
Well, so that's where it gets even more interesting. I think that makes perfect sense to say. Like, well, when we think about God being angry, we have this anthropomorphic conception because. Mm-hmm. Lactantius will go on and he'll say, anger is actually needed in order to give us the energy to right injustice. It was very Platonic, you know?
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah. Now, he also attacks these other mistaken positions of the philosophers, and here he does something really interesting. He's going to say, you guys defined anger the wrong way. You managed to define bad anger, but not good anger. So he says the Stoics, they didn't realize the difference between just and unjust anger. So they, you know, if you think all anger is bad, it makes good sense. You'd say, well, don't be angry, right? Which is what the Stoics said. The Peripatetics, the Aristotelians, they thought, well, anger is not good, but we can regulate it. We can moderate it. So get angry to the right degree at the right time with the right people. You remember all that sort of stuff. And he says, the problem is they're all defining anger the wrong way. What are they defining anger as? The desire for revenge. the desire to impose suffering on another person in retaliation. When what they ought to have had is a definition, here's the definition he gives. Anger is a emotion of the mind arousing itself for the restraining of faults or setting things right. And he says anger is needed for this in order to make things happen.
Yeah.
Now, we could go back to that. Is this anger in the same sense that we feel it? He doesn't talk about that. Other later Christian thinkers will say, yeah, God doesn't feel emotions like we do, where, you know, our hands clench and things like that. Even if we are feeling the right kind of anger, and we're setting things correct, we may have this whole bodily response. Well, God doesn't have a body, so it's not that sort of thing. He's not really working out those sort of implications. This is very early on.
But doesn't anger give direction in the sense that you make corrections or you make positive decisions?
Yeah.
Rather than negative into the revenge area?
Well,
it's like a fork.
Yeah, the trouble with human beings is that we can have, first we can be influenced by the anger that just is about revenge. So let's put that aside. Even with the anger that we feel that's rightly directed, because, I see somebody treating you badly and I intervene, I could still go too far with that. Somebody is saying something mean to you and I go punch them out, maybe that's excessive. Mm. Hopefully, God isn't doing that sort of thing, right? I mean, God is, if you think about how this schema works, God is actually, in some ways, too lenient. He lets the wicked get away with too much for too long. We'd like him to come down right away and start, setting things right.
We all have a different definition of sometimes.
What's that?
What is right. We all have a definition
sometimes
of what is right.
Yeah, these guys are not moral subjectivists. They think that there's some general conception. We can get it wrong, we can get it right. The wicked, part of why they go wrong is because they deform their personalities so much that they think, abusing other people is the right thing to do. Just because they think it's that way doesn't mean that it's actually the case. These guys all presume that there is some sort of, moral code that is universal. Not everybody necessarily gets it, but that's part of the problem. But they think God would be governed by that, or God would express it or something like that, So let's go on with this. There's another Christian objection that he considers. And this is a good one. What about the fact that God is so far from being angry that he tells us not to be angry? There's, in those New Testament passages, the first one is that one from the Sermon on the Mount. He who is angry with his brother, will be subject to the judgment. And so the response there that he has, he says, well, yeah, human anger is to be curbed. Why? Because we screw it up. We often are angry unjustly, and we do terrible things to each other. Our anger is unreliable. It doesn't go on the way it ought to. But if God was to tell us, look, don't get angry at all, he'd be kind of contradicting himself. Because he put anger in us. He actually says he put anger in our livers because the view at that time was that anger was associated with gall, and gall comes from your liver. And so, look, if God didn't want us to be angry, he shouldn't have put livers in there. So God can't be saying don't get angry at all. And then he tells us also, get angry but don't sin. So he wasn't tearing up anger altogether. He was trying to tell us to restrain it, to when we correct people, we do so out of justice and moderation, not out of just a desire to stick to them, to use the occasion to put ourselves forward. And then he has some interesting reflections on eternity and time. He says that because God is eternal, his anger remains into eternity. And that sounds pretty scary then, right? So if I, there are a lot of people who have this kind of view of God. If I screw up once, I'm screwed. I can never put things right, And he says, well, God also controls anger by his will. And so what is God's will? It's that we actually get ourselves on the right track and quit screwing up and, have a repentance, a metanoia, change of mind, and say, I'm not going to do these things that make God angry. because, you know, they hurt other people or they're violating other people's rights or things like that. So he says, for those who repent, God has already seen from eternity that they're going to do that. And there's, you know, problems associated with that that get way beyond, you know, our scope here in talking about anger, metaphysical problems about predestination and all that. But so he says, repentance and mercy is possible when a person engages in a reformation of morals. So again, very much like the prophets. I don't want your sacrifices, you know. I don't want you to just go along with, you know, nonsense rules. I want to see you change the way you behave towards other people. And then I won't be angry. But those who remain in their, you know, their behavior, he says God remains angry with them for eternity. So in a certain way, the human being has control over, this is again fraught with theological significance, in a certain way that the human being in the choice that they make has control over whether God remains angry with them or not. But they, you know, it's not like they get to choose, I'm just going to send God a I'm sorry card and then everything's going to be okay. They have, if they're a really, you know, terrible bastard, they have to change that.
Confess.
Well, it's not enough to confess, you know. You have to actually change the way that you act. So the idea of like, I'm just going to get off the hook by going to confession. Sooner or later, if you do that and you have a good confessor, you know, that person, after they hear the same stuff over and over again, they're gonna put two and two together, and they're gonna say, "Why do you keep coming in here and confessing this same thing? Do you think you could stop doing that?" You know? And so Tertullian, or not, Lactantius, would you know, he'd be of that mindset too. Look, if you wanna not have God angry at you, rightly angry at you, you need to quit doing wrong things. And so just saying I'm sorry, you know, that's not going to cut it. That's a good first step, but then you've got to knock it off, you know. And so, you know, along with this would go things like, well, thinking about why you do wrong things. So if you're let's say you're mean to people because you're very competitive, right? Then you probably need to look at your competitiveness so that you can you know, put that, you can stop having that have so much influence over you so it doesn't lead to the behavior. If it's because you're just a mean person, well, I don't know what you do then, but, you know, you're probably going to have to, like, impose restrictions on yourself. So it's calling for the person to take more self-control in certain ways, you know? But again, he doesn't provide us with anything more than that. So let's go on. Let's talk about John Chrysostom. He's a guy who's particularly fun to read. His name actually means golden mouth. He was renowned for his eloquence. Beautiful writer. He was an Antiochian Christian, so he's a Syrian of Greek and Syrian parents. Eventually, he becomes a patriarch of Constantinople. Major Eastern theologian. He, unlike many of the other guys doing scripture at the time, would have these, you know, wonderful allegorical things. Well, the this means that and this means that. He was a bit more commonsensical. He was focused on what we call the moral meaning of scripture, the moral sense of scripture. He was interested in what the teachings were and how they would affect our lives. So he has these homilies on Matthew. And like I was saying before, that passage, I'll just read the passage. This is from the Sermon on the Mount. You've heard that it was said to those of ancient times, you shall not murder, and whosoever murders shall be liable to judgment. But I say to you that if you are angry with a brother or sister, and then there's this bracketed clause in there, without cause, a lot of the manuscripts have that in there. The oldest manuscripts don't have that in there. But this is a common reading in ancient Christianity. The King James Version, by the way, going back to, you know, ancient Greek texts, used the without cause, because they weren't using the oldest Greek texts. So we're going to see these thinkers taking up this question of the with or without cause. But he says, if you're angry with a brother or sister, you will be liable to judgment. And if you insult a brother or sister by saying, you know, raka, you will be liable to the council. And if you say, you fool, you will be liable to the hell of fire. So when you're offering your gift at the altar, if you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. first be reconciled to your brother or sister, and then come and offer your gift. So this provoked a lot of Christian reflection on should we ever get angry? What's the nature of anger? How far should we go? And then, you know, also, why did he tell us this three times? You know, are these like three levels? You know, are we getting three chances? What's going on in this passage? And so Chrysostom says, Christ isn't saying never be angry at all, in part because it's not possible to be entirely free of passions. We're supposed to get control over them, but it's not possible to get rid of that. And he even says anger can be useful if we know how to use it at the suitable time. For example, Paul's anger at the Corinthians. Paul writes the letters to the Corinthians in part because they're screwing up. And he gets mad at them and says, look, you guys, knock this off, you know. That would be a good use of anger. So here's the key question then. Now we're starting to get some real moral doctrine about anger. When is it the proper time? Chrysostom says, when we're not avenging ourselves, but checking others in their lawless deeds, we've seen this one already, or forcing them to attend to their negligence. We ought to get angry when others are unjustly harmed as well. So those are three criteria that tell us we can look at our anger, and if we're being honest with ourselves, which is tough to do, we could say, does it fall under any of these three? Then it could be okay to be angry. Are we just trying to revenge ourselves? Well, then we shouldn't follow that anger. We shouldn't even get angry like that. He says, when is it not? Well, you know, when we're avenging ourselves. And then he brings in another thing. When we're contending for riches. That's an interesting point to bring in. When we're being competitive with other people, it's bad for us to get angry. And he brings up riches. He doesn't say when we're, like, you know, competing for mates, or trying to get, you know, the most food at the table. He thinks there's something about greed that is particularly anger-provoking.
It's like the political debate. You see, they couldn't get angry.
You mean the last night?
Yeah, they couldn't get angry, you
yeah.
see.
Well, Christy kind of looked a little angry. He did pretty good at that, but he gave some smackdowns. And there's risks with that, because if you show yourself as the angry person, then you kind of lose. Now, what about these other things? You know, saying raka, you know, this meaningless word to your brother. He says, well, that's an expression of contempt and slight, so it's disrespectful. You know, we do disrespectful things when we get angry. We might not say raka, which is this Aramaic word, kind of a nonsense word. We like mutter under our breath, or we look at people in a mean way, we slam doors, that sort of thing. And then he says, now, why is it so bad to say you fool to your brother? He says, well, this seems very burdensome and hyperbolic to some people. He's admitting that some Christians say, oh, what's the big deal with calling somebody a fool? You know, God's going to throw you into hell for that. What a jerk God is, you know. And then he says, well, we shouldn't see this as a mere word. We should look at this as an expression of a fundamental attitude, an attitude from which great evil can develop, a hatred for the other person, a wish for them not to even be. This is the great danger with anger. So he says God was actually being merciful to us in giving us this threefold injunction. Why? Because he didn't just say, look, don't get angry. He's like giving us this complex thing, and he's giving us three chances. Because first we can, you know, get angry. We could put a stop to that. If we get angry, we don't have to express it to the other person, although we often love to do that, right? And if we do that expression, we don't have to go further and you know, call the person a fool or just say that they're totally without value. We don't have to treat them as a non-person. Now, in other places, he talks about anger as being much less positive. He says in the homilies on John that anger is truly an evil, and he says, look at angry people quarreling in the marketplace. When you're involved, you can't even see how stupid and disgraceful it is because you're doing it and you think that it's okay. But when others do it, then look at them. You know, they look like jackasses.
Sure.
Do you want to look like that? You know, this is what you're talking about with the debate thing, right?
Yeah.
If you give in and it's on national TV, then, you know, it feels good to you at the time. But people are like, wow, I don't like that. I don't want to be around that person. He discusses times when the Jews were angry and wanted to kill Christ. And he says, we should learn from Christ's example of mildness, that anger is a, he calls it, dreadful wild beast that we should bridle. And he says, it's worse than being insane or being possessed by a devil. Why? Because the insane and those possessed by devils, it's not their own fault. But when we get angry and we lose our temper, it's us that is to blame. He also comments on that passage, that another very important one from the Ephesians. Let me bring that one up because the others are going to talk about it too. This is Paul, and he says, be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and do not make room for the devil. Thieves must give up stealing. Rather let them labor and work honestly with their own hands so as to have something to share with the needy. Let no evil come out of your mouths, but only what is useful for building up. He goes on. And then he says, put away from you all bitterness and wrath and anger and wrangling and slander together with all malice. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ has forgiven you. This is a really key passage in the New Testament for Christian thinkers on anger, in part because it says, be angry, but do not sin. So how do you parse that out? And John Chrysostom says that Paul is prescribing what the sick person should do, like a doctor. And he's not treating the person with contempt, but trying to persuade them. He says it would be good to never be angry, but if you do fall into the passion, try not to do it so much. And then he says there's a reason for this additional injunction. Do not let the sun go down in your anger. And his discussion of it is very interesting. This comes up not only in this work, but in a number of other places as well. He says, if the night comes and you're still angry, you're in your bed, you're alone, now you're going to stew and dwell on those thoughts. Right? In the daytime, you can distract yourself with the busyness and all that sort of stuff. But when you're by yourself, if you haven't gotten rid of that anger, it's actually going to grow.
In the marital life, sometimes the spouses will say, let's not go to bed
angry.
Yeah. We'll kiss and make up.
Yeah. I think he even thinks, too, like you're going to have angry dreams. And so he says, if you only, he's got this metaphor. So think about people who would have a fireplace or a stove or something. If any of you ever, grew up with that sort of thing, we had wood-burning stoves. You want to make sure that there's something burning in the stove so that you don't have to restart it, right? But if it's anger, you don't want it to be sitting in there glowing, because even if there's just a little bit left, all it takes is putting a little bit more fuel in there and it blazes right back up. So we don't want to let the sun go down on our anger, he says. And then with the put away all bitterness and wrath and anger, he says, look, all sorts of moral weaknesses make one liable to anger. Why is Paul saying put away not just wrath and anger, but bitterness? Because bitterness leads to anger.
Yeah.
A lot of these other things, if we don't get rid of them, if we want to do anger management well, you might put it this way, we can't just focus on the anger. We have to focus on the other things that are bugging us, and the other perhaps vicious dispositions that we have. So he's also got an interesting discussion with some advice. Accustom the soul never to cry out in clamor, he says. And he sees this as a problem particularly in ancient times with women who are allowed to get away with more than men with respect to anger because they express it in different ways. So he says, men will like punch each other and do these bad things to each other. And then in comes the law, takes them away, imposes a penalty on them. Women will just yell inside the house and, raise hell with the servants and, yell at their husbands and all that. And nobody's going to come and take them away. So they're, you don't want to be like that. You don't want to be indulging your anger in ways that aren't being punished. Because look, it's still indulging anger. It's still bad for you. Let's talk now about Augustine. So Augustine, Chrysostom is in the East. Augustine is in the West. A lot of us are very familiar with him. He's one of the main Western Christian fathers. He's a convert to Christianity. He's a saint that I particularly like because he shows that there's hope for those of us who don't live a wonderful life at the beginning, the way some of these saints do. He was a saint who knew sin in large part by doing it. If you ever read his confessions, you know, he led a pretty dissolute life. He also tried to, like, get on the straight path, and then he'd fall off and, you know, had a kid out of wedlock and disappointed his mom and, oh, he's just a big mess, right? Got involved in a cult, you know, had to leave the cult. In any case, he has a more positive attitude towards anger than a lot of Christian thinkers. In talking about it, he, you know, looking at the Sermon on the Mount discussion, he says, anger admits of degrees. Whoever is angry with his brother, you know, without cause, he accepts it without cause, is going to be in danger of the judgment. And then we have the other two. So he says there's a gradation. The first one is being angry and keeping the feeling as a conception in their heart. Not a good thing, but, you know, not as bad as the other two. And he says, if you don't keep it in your heart, then the emotion is going to draw forth an expression of anger, which doesn't have any definite meaning. Raka, he says, is just a nonsense word, but it gives evidence of the feeling of the mind. Just like, you know, when you glare at somebody, you know, you're not actually enunciating something, but they know what you mean, you know. Sometimes angry people just start spluttering. They can't, you know, say anything coherent. You can tell they're angry, right? So, and then he says, when we get to the third level, the calling your brother a fool, it's not merely an expression of anger. It's also a word by which the party now using it indicates and signifies a direct censure. You're coming down on the person. I'm talking about judgment, right? Judgment not in the sense of, like, you know, a judge inflicting judgment, but rather like being judgmental. You're saying this person is so stupid, they don't really have a right to say anything or be anything. And then he says, beyond this, there's actions. And the reason why, you know, there's this, or, you know, there's this discussion first of you're not supposed to kill. Whoever kills is going to be subject. Because anger often does lead to killing. So it goes beyond just calling somebody a fool. If you think somebody's a fool, you think they're a worthless person, that makes it a lot easier to do terrible things to them. What's that?
I laughingly said, eliminate them.
Yeah. Well, you know, that's part of it. There's an interesting contrast, too, between anger and hatred. We saw this with Aristotle. The angry person wants to inflict harm. The person who hates literally wants the other person not to exist. So you know, liquidating or eradicating a whole class of people. But anger and hatred kind of, you know, they verge into each other. And Augustine calls attention to the fact that if we're not careful, anger will turn into hatred. I'll get to that in just a moment. In the City of God, he says, in our ethics, we don't inquire as whether a person, a pious soul, is angry as to why they're angry. So the question is then, can it be all right, not good, but certainly just not terrible, to be angry? And he says, in discussions of the Sermon on the Mount, we have to rely on this notion of the without cause. If you actually have cause to be angry, it could be good for you to be angry. He says it should be assumed in reading the other verses. And then later, he in the City of God, he says, I'm not aware any right-thinking person would find fault with anger as a wrongdoer that seeks his amendment. He says it even has an important role, if rightly directed, in rectifying conditions and people through chastening and amendment. And then, you know, he also talks about correcting children, that not only animals, or not only humans, but animals do this. And he brings up herbivores. You know, it's one thing to say, well, you know, the lions discipline each other because lions are angry and all that. Cows, you know, and horses, if they see their kid doing something wrong, they'll give them a little nip. You know, so. Yeah. Well, I don't know what's really going on in a cow's head. You know, myself, but
all species have their way of putting them in line, you know, putting their...
Yeah, I mean, certainly the mammals do. Yeah, the mammals that are occupied with their young. Maybe the birds. I don't really know. That's a really interesting question about animal behavior and anger. But he says now, this is still a sign of our own weakness. The reason why we have to do this stuff is because of our fallen condition. It's not like the angels actually feel anger when they punish. So this goes to that question that you were asking earlier about, wouldn't it be, you know, better to do this without emotion? Augustine is like the Stoics in this respect. It's better to punish without feeling any sort of thing. He also has some interesting cautions, and this is in letter 38. He says, no one who is angry considers his anger to be unjust. Isn't that true? When we're angry, we think we're doing the right thing. It's later on that we look at it and we're like, oh, that was not the right thing to do. And he says, anger that's habitually cherished against any person is going to inevitably become hatred. So it's going to lead to these worse things. He says, the reason why this happens is the sweetness which is mingled with what appears to be righteous anger makes it detain it longer than we ought to in the vessel of ourselves. And he says, it's better for us then to forbear from anger, even when one has given us just occasion for it, than beginning from what seems to be just anger to fall through this hidden tendency of the passion into hatred. Because of anger's tendency to turn into hatred, we have to be very, very careful with it. And even when we think that we're right, we have to be suspicious of whether we are right.
So it's disapproval. You don't have to really get that angry. You just disapprove.
Yeah. That would be one way around it. I mean, I think Augustine would probably say it's better if we don't feel any sort of negative emotion, but we're probably going to.
Then we'd be robots.
Yeah, I mean, that's an interesting question. I mean, from the Christian perspective, we wouldn't feel no emotions. We would still feel joy, gratitude, love, these sorts of things.
We'd have the opposite of that.
Well, that's sort of like what Lactantius was saying. So Augustine and Lactantius are different in this respect. You see, the different Christian authors have somewhat different psychologies from each other.
Well, if it's a result of the fallen condition,
yeah,
then you can't really escape it, so you have to find a way to make it work and be positive.
Yeah, to minimize the bad effects, right? Until we get up to heaven, and then we won't get angry at anything. Things will be okay then. But that isn't now. That's very clear, right? Let's turn to John Cassian now. Here we have a very different perspective on anger than what we've seen so far. Cassian, by the way, I want to tell you a little bit about his biography. He was a Latin Westerner, and he goes east. And he goes east because he wants to experience and understand the monastic life. And back then, there were a couple places that you would go to to experience monasticism sort of like in its, I don't know, sort of in its greatest form. So first he goes to Palestine. People would go out into the desert. Monachos means, it comes from the Greek word for alone. And so the early monks would go out, be by themselves. The idea is you withdraw from society so you can spend time in prayer and contemplation. Pretty quickly they realize you actually got to do, more work in that case because somebody's got to be, providing the food, cleaning the place, all this sort of stuff. And so they develop a kind of rule, a life community. Yeah, and so the early monks were people who did this voluntarily, and it was one of those sort of things where people would, you'd say, I'm going to go join the monastery, and people would be like, wow, you must be nuts. What are you getting yourself into? A lot of people would also say, well, pray for us because you're going to have more time to pray than we do. But it was viewed as, kind of a dangerous thing to do. But the monks, on the other hand, said, well, look, the lures of problems in the world are so, tough that I probably need to do this. Some people can make it while having a house and a business and all that. I can't. I need to go out and do this. So Cassian goes out there with his friend Germanus to study Christian philosophy. Christian philosophy at that time, philosophia, doesn't just mean like stuff in books. It means a way of life, a lived wisdom that's being communicated. So first he goes to Palestine, because he's going to experience that. But if you're really hardcore, there's only one place to go to really do the monasticism, and that's the Egyptian desert.
That's what I was going to say.
Yeah. So, because the Palestinians are actually telling him that they're the more serious types. You want to go to monastic graduate school? That's the place to go. And so he goes out, and they live with these monks in the desert, and he gets in conversations, which are recorded, bits and pieces of which in the conferences with some of the abbots and some of the important monks. And then he returns to the West, and he writes these two books that are going to play an important role in Christian monasticism in Western Europe. The Institutes, where he's laying out sort of, in part, an ideal way to understand the monastic community, you know, some injunctions about when you should say the Psalms and how to do that sort of thing. And then he writes the Conferences, which are these conversations with these great monastic leaders and thinkers. Those end up being important because Saint Benedict, when he forms his rule, Benedictine monks are one of the older and more widespread orders in Western Christianity. Benedict actually picks out Cassian as one of the people the monks should read. So throughout Benedictine monasticism, they're reading John Cassian. Now, why is John Cassian so important in other respects? You guys have all heard of the seven deadly sins. Mm-hmm. Originally, they were eight. And they were not looked at as the seven deadly sins or the eight deadly sins. They were called the eight capital vices. And if you look at not popular but you know more you know scholastic treatments of this, you will see that people like Thomas Aquinas will still talk about it not just in terms of seven deadly sins but seven capital vices, because this is being preserved. They're not sins in the sense of, well, look, if you do these seven things, God is going to, like, you know, really be ticked off at you. So don't lust or don't be vain or anything like that. They're understood as vices. So they're part of the soul. They creep in. They get a hold of who you are, and they deform the personality. And the reason why they're deadly sins or capital vices is because they're productive of a whole bunch of other ones. It's not that they themselves are terrible in themselves. It's that they lead to so many other consequences. So think about anger now. Think about all the things that people do when they're angry. They're not all necessarily about anger. You know, there's a whole bunch of other things. Anger itself is bad. But now, Cassian doesn't come up with this by himself. And he's actually getting this from the other monks. But they are getting it, and I gave you this handout, from this guy, Evagrius of Pontus. And at that time, they're called the Eight Thoughts. They're viewed as eight ways of thinking about things that creep into the soul, that the devil suggests to people. And then they end up taking control over the person. So these, you know, a lot of these are familiar to you. Gluttony, right? People don't just overeat because they have a desire for it. They also tell themselves things. There are thoughts involved, like, yeah, maybe thirds is good for me, or there's nothing wrong with a midnight snack, or, you know, I should have a third dessert because I didn't get dessert yesterday, you know. All these sorts of things that people will tell themselves, right? I'm going to start losing weight next month, and then I'm going to be doing good. So I should really enjoy myself as much as possible now. Or, you know, I mean, thoughts with gluttony could be things that are also tied in with other views, like, well, you know, I know a lot of people are starving, but I don't have to worry about that because I got plenty of food here and, you know, better than me. All these sorts of things can fit into that. So gluttony is one. Gluttony is actually felt to be a pretty low-level thing. It's, you know, you have to get it under control, but it's not anywhere as bad as these other ones. Lust. Lust was felt to be a bad thing, but not super terrible. It's nowhere near as bad as anger. But lust will make us do crazy stuff too. Greed or love of money. Philargyrus literally means love of silver. Yeah, but again, not as bad as some of the more spiritual sins. For the ancient monks, sadness or lupes was viewed sort of like being in a constantly depressed state was viewed as a capital vice. Then, of course, anger is talked about. Acadia, which we don't have a good translation for, that's the one that's referred to sometimes as the devil that comes by noonday. You might think of it as being distracted, willfully distracting yourself, not tying down. By the way, as they become the seven deadly sins, sadness and Acadia are going to get rolled together into sloth. That's why you don't see sloth on here. Vainglory, vanity, kenodoxia, literally having, you know, an empty opinion of yourself. That's by the way, hearkening back to Epicurus and these empty opinions, kenodoxia. And then finally, pride. Pride is the worst of all of them. They actually distinguish between vainglory and pride in these discussions. Later on, they're going to kind of get rolled together, you know?
But more like hubris.
Yeah, I mean
pride.
Yeah.
I never understand that. Pride, to me, is what kept my life together.
Well, it might not be pride in the sense that they're talking
about.
You know, they're not talking about having a healthy self-conception. They're talking about the pride that sets us over everybody else, that says that we're the center of the world, screw everybody else, they exist for us, that sort of thing. Mm. Kenodoxia is more like, people who are, you know, we talk about vanity, like, oh, look at my tie. This is an exclusive tie. You know, I'm so cool because I've got the tie that nobody else does. And by the time that you guys go out and buy this, all have moved on to the next one. That'd be kenodoxia, right?
Like a braggadocia.
Yeah, that's a good. And we have like a whole fashion industry that caters to that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. So let's go back to anger now. So, on a psychological level, Cassian sketches a number of different vivid images and shapes that anger takes. He devotes an entire book to anger in his institutes. And he's not so much interested in defining or systematically discussing the mechanism of anger. He's inheriting this basic philosophical stance from Neoplatonism. But he does note from the abbot Serapion, anger arises in response to what is outside of us for the most part. It has its seed plot, though, within us. So there's an external and an internal component to it. And he says 6 of the 8 principal faults are connected with each other in such a way as they easily give rise to each other. So gluttony, lust, greed, dejection or sadness, acadia, all of these can dispose us to anger. When we're gluttonous and we don't get, so we're gluttonous and we're going up to the buffet, right? And then they suddenly take away. they take away the stuff we like.
Ice cream or something.
Yeah. And we're like, ah, damn it. The world is unfair, you know. Lust, you know, same thing can happen with that, right? You like somebody and they don't like you. Now you're angry at them or the person they're going out with or, you know, the world, stuff like that. Anger can also cause these, he says as well. Anger can take the form of compulsive eating or trying to lose oneself in the body of another or in greed, you know, piling. I'm going to show you bastards, I'll accumulate a whole bunch of money and then, you know, we'll see who's on top, all these sorts of things. It can also lead to what he calls sadness or depression, this lupe. And it can also dispose us towards this distracted frame of mind in Acadia. In Acadia, he talks about like the monk. I think we can all relate to this. Social media, by the way, is terrible for making us subject to Acadia. So he talks about monks who are supposed to be like doing their business in their cell. And they're like, before I do this, I should probably go check on Brother John over there and see if he needs anything. You know? I'll get back to what my business, but let me just go do this. And then he gets to Brother John and he's like, you know, I think maybe Brother Jeremiah over there could also use my help. And he keeps like flitting from thing to thing, never gets anything done, right? And then suddenly the day is gone. That's Acadia. And anger can make us do that to distract ourselves, they say. He also distinguishes 3 kinds of anger, or 3 modes of anger. He calls 1 thumos, which rages within us, you know, and we're like dwelling on our anger. Orge breaks out in word or in deed or in action. And then there's this one that we encountered at the very beginning of these lectures, menis, M-E-N-I-S. The rage that Achilles felt. This is the one that lasts for days and for long periods. So you've got these 3 different modalities of anger.
I'm too cold.
That's all right. So he says, anger, here's where he's going to differ from other thinkers. Augustine said, you know, anger could be some place for it. Chrysostom said that. Lactantius said, yeah, we can be angry when we're punishing. Just be really careful with that. John Cassian says, anger is always bad. Always bad. Never good. The only possible exception, the only time anger is acceptable, is when it's directed against ourselves and our faults, particularly our anger itself. Every other time of getting angry is seducing us away from where we're supposed to be. Yeah.
So as you're talking, I'm thinking about a young child, like a two-year-old, have a tantrum, and, you know, that's really so blunt out. Yeah. Anger. But it does seem anger is really, especially if you don't grow out of that stage, it's all centered around, the world revolves around me. You know,
yeah.
It's all very self-centered. Oh, I go to the buffet table and what I want is not there, and I'm going to have like a temper, a two-year-old. Mm-hmm. So
yeah.
It seems like anger is related to not maturing. Like some people are stuck like as a teenager or stuck
yeah.
like very self-centered. And not, I don't know, just Buddhism focuses more on things as they are and think, you know, accepting what is. And you have to be mature to accept what is and say, you know, I want this, I want what I want, and I deserve, entitled, or
yeah.
It just seems like related to immaturity.
That's one of the points where Christian monasticism and asceticism and Buddhist monasticism and asceticism really converge on some of the same points, and others too. I mean, Hindu asceticism as well. That notion that, you know, in authors that are being influenced by Cassian, like St. Anselm, he'll talk about, he's not the only guy to talk about humility. And when he means humility, he means a genuine notion of who one is that takes into account really how little the self is in comparison to everybody else, that we, you know, we do matter as persons, but we don't matter so much that our, yeah, it doesn't become exclusive, it doesn't rule out everybody else, because God made a whole cosmos with billions of other beings.
And we're all connected in some way,
yeah.
You know, if you want to go that far. But it does seem to need a maturity to be able to
yeah.
overcome anger. It's like some level of the world is more than just me. You know?
It's interesting when I think about that. Sometimes you need other people's anger displayed towards you to get how screwed up your own behavior is,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
And that other anger isn't good in itself, and maybe they're even doing it out of their own being a jerk and stuff like that, but it can help for you. I'm thinking of two particular examples from my own experience. One was I used to blow up at students quite a bit when I was first teaching, and I was doing it in a maximum security prison. And yeah, well, yes and no, because they also, you know, respected it.
They understood it; that's their language.
Yeah, and so there was this guy who I eventually became good friends with, and he was in one of my very first classes, and he. I think he said something like, well, my opinion on this is, and I like blew up at him, and I said, nobody gives a shit about your opinion. You know, we're not here in college classes just to like throw out our opinions on stuff. Your opinion matters if you can actually like make other people realize why it matters by giving some sort of evidence for it. And then he like shut up, and I was thinking, you know, as I went home, I'm like, well, that was kind of hard at him, but you know.
Mm-hmm.
So he came up to me like 2 years later. And he said, you know, you saying that to me was exactly what I needed to hear at the time.
Mm-hmm.
I was really mad at you. And then I went back to my cell and I thought about this. And I realized that my own opinion, at least as far as college goes, really doesn't matter. And it gave him a spur. And then, so finally he came up and he said, you know, I wanted to talk with you. And we got to be really good friends in part because of that. And I was tempted actually to say, you see, that's exactly why I did it. But I didn't do it for that reason. I did that because I had anger problems and I was coming down hard on a student. you know. Right.
But you taught him something, but you could have said the same thing in a not an angry
tone. Yeah, you're right. And but if I did, it might not have actually had the effect on him.
Maybe not.
I know from my own life, because I've been quite a screw up. I remember, I had many occasions like that in reverse, and I remember I was a ward of the court at one time, in part because of my anger problems and getting in fights and aggressivity. My mom filed an uncontrollability petition and had me, you know, become a ward of the court. And so I was in this place called Shelter Care in Waukesha County, and I was, you know, I was being a jerk a lot of the time to the staff, and one of the guys brought me into the office, and he said, look, I'm going to swear a little bit here. He said, if you want to be treated like an asshole, keep acting like an asshole. And he didn't say it in like a raging way, but it was clear that he was tired of my nonsense, right. You know. And I went back to, you know, my place. And, of course, I was like angry at him. Who are you? Tell me that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. But then I thought about it and I was like, well, maybe I'll try not acting like a jerk, you know. And then suddenly things got better for me. And, of course, I had less things to be angry about. And if he had said it in a way that was not, that didn't have that sort of like background of menace to it, like, I'm tired of your crap, kid.
But you know? Maybe he wasn't angry. Maybe he was just saying, this is like an actor.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Like, your language. The way to portray this, this is how this kid's going to hear it. It wasn't coming from... You know, that he wasn't, you know, he was...
That might be the case. I suspect, given, you know, what most of those jobs are like and how overworked they tend to be, he probably was angry with me. But it could have also been the kind of anger that we were talking about with some of these other people where, because it's directed at correcting faults, not at just taking revenge. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not like the guy was, like, looking... to bring me into his office and have... This is like something he didn't want to have to do. Maybe it's more like what Lactantius was talking about.
But in the prison...
Yeah.
It could very well be that because you reacted in that way, that prisoner saw an honesty in the way you...
That I was
you
more
responded.
Like him.
No, that you... That in a way, he looked at it because he realized you did understand because you had that ability. You know, you had that fault, but yet you were giving him good... You were saying... You know what I'm saying?
I was giving him
sometimes
good advice, but I was giving it...
This condescension people come up with in, you know, doing everything...
Yeah.
You know, being the one. You know, you're the angry prisoner, and you're the one who's having all these problems, and somebody comes and says, well, you shouldn't do it that way because, you know, this is the way. They don't want to hear that.
Yeah.
They don't.
You know, there might be a temperament aspect to this, too, because, like, I know I would rather, and I come from a family of people like this, where I would rather have somebody yell at me and tell me what I'm doing wrong than sort of, like, you know, in a very calm way go through the whole thing and, you know... It feels kind of condescending. Mm-hmm. At least with anger, and this may be part of, you know, my being screwed up. At least with anger, there's a sense in which you're on the same plane as the person shouting back and forth at them. But it can be so destructive. Yeah, go ahead.
Well, during these periods with all of this writing and these arguments back and forth, were there any prominent in history non-believers that... had things to say about, you know, with all
about
these
anger?
Christians talking
about what the Christians were saying.
About, you know, because obviously non-believers don't believe in God and heaven and hell.
At that time, usually non-believers believed in some other religious system. Most people were religious back then in one way. I don't know about... too many anti-Christian polemics having to do with anger. There was this sense that Christianity is too meek. It's going to sap our military because we need you know, people who are courageous and angry and all that sort of stuff. And these Christians make everybody too mild.
Survival type of, you know.
Yeah. And, you know, I know about other anti-Christian or even just like, let's make fun of the Christian kind of polemics about other things, like, you know, like Lucian, for example, will make fun of the Christians, but he doesn't really know much about them. I would suspect that there probably was a lot more of that, and we've probably lost a lot of it, because we've lost most of the literature of antiquity. And so there wouldn't have been a hell of a lot of reason to hold on to that stuff when the monks were the ones who were mostly the ones transmitting things. Although they saved some pretty surprising stuff. I mean, they would save Ovid. You know, the Art of Love is almost pornographic, but the monks, you know, they preserved it. They thought it was worth reading.
They had illuminated manuscripts.
Yeah.
Who knows?
Oftentimes they would sort of Christianize these things in a way. You know, this could be talked about how the soul ascends to God or things like that. But yeah, that's a good question. I don't know enough about it, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. But let's go back to Cassian. So I mentioned he thinks anger is just always bad. You know, so he's different than these other people. He says that anger is very harmful, that it should not be allowed any place within us. There's no anger with the other person that's right. And he talks about that without cause clause. And he says, those who use that as an excuse are doing the wrong thing. So in a way, he's implicitly criticizing people like Augustine or you know, Chrysostom. You know, the only time it's really acceptable is when it's directed against our faults. He also says we have to really watch out being angry with non-personal, inanimate things. The monk out in the desert will get angry at his book or at his mat for not rolling upright or at the wind or at all this sort of stuff. He says we have to watch out for passive-aggressive transformed types of anger. And he talks about these monks who would, you know, pretend that they're not angry with other monks, but would be talking to them in ways that show that they really, you know, despise them or hate them. And he's talking about what we call passive aggressivity. And he says that this is good advice not only for monks, that they're particularly prone to it because they know they're not supposed to get angry. It's also good advice for people who are stuck in, you know, the one down position, who are stuck taking it. If you are being passive aggressive, the problem is you're still harboring anger within yourself. He says that not only should we not be angry, we should practice and cultivate the virtue of patience. We should also spend a lot of time not trying to make other people angry. You know, it's not enough for us not to get angry ourselves. We need to figure out why we're provoking other people to this thing that's bad for them of getting angry. And that's very similar to, you know, like the notion of compassion in Buddhism. We should try to reconcile with them, or we should try to forgive them, he says. So he also gives us some advice about how to work on anger. Part of this is through close attention to the self. This is one of the things the monks spent a lot of time on. Being careful to discern when anger has crept in or taken new forms that we're inclined to excuse or justify in ourselves. We also have to take responsibility for our own anger. He says it rises as a response to what's outside, but it's not actually entirely from outside. It takes root here in us because we allow it, our own habits, our tendencies, perhaps even our temperaments. So we have to reshape our habits. We have to, and there's, you know, anger management got this right, at least. If we want to not be angry with people, at least not as much, we have to work not only on changing, you know, beliefs or things like that, we have to do it over time, right? You have to keep a journal. Did I get angry today? What did I get angry about? So that you can eventually change it, you know, into new habits. He also says that there's a supernatural dimension to this. Not surprising. He's a Christian monk. He thinks that prayer plays an important role in this, that grace plays a role too. His view of grace is not like something that just comes from God and radically changes us. It's more like we're given a shot by God, and now it's up to us with what we do with it. We either cooperate with it or we waste it. But he also thinks that fasting is important. This is typically monastic views. Fasting, it's a way of disciplining not just the body, but also the soul. And now, if you fast too much, you're going to be so tired you can't get angry anyway, you might think. But people also do become very irritable when they fast. Saint Anselm, who we're not really, he's a much later thinker. He has a piece where he actually says, and Anselm was a guy who fasted a lot. He says, it's really better not to fast if fasting just makes you irritable with people. First deal with your anger problems, then start fasting. Cassian would say, look, that's fine, but you got to fast first because you're going to need that for controlling any of the other vices. Fasting, getting control over gluttony is absolutely essential. The other thing that he says that's really interesting is that we need guidance by other people. There's a passage in the Institutes where Cassian says one single human being cannot possess all the virtues. As opposed to Aristotle and like later on Thomas Aquinas, people who say you can't have one person who has all the virtues. As a matter of fact, if you're going to be virtuous in one way, you may as well be virtuous in the other ways. Cassian says it doesn't work that way. That's why we need a community. Because I can develop this virtue, and then I'm a screw-up in all these other ways. You develop this virtue, you're a screw-up in other ways. The only way in which we all enjoy these virtues is together as a community. And he says the only person who had all these virtues is Christ. So the only way to have it is in a community. So we need guidance by other people for Cassian. It's too easy, just like with all our other faults, for the angry part of ourself to justify itself and to win over reason to its side and start, you know, saying it's okay for us to behave this way. So, you know, what would be the guidance that we need? We would need scripture, of course, like these passages, you know, don't let the sun go down on your anger. That's understood as sort of a living voice of God telling people what to do. So scripture, they would practice this through the Liturgy of the Hours. If you do the Liturgy of the Hours, you're going to read the entirety of the Psalms every so often. These become part of the fabric of one's thought. But you also need people that you can, like, you know, sit across the table from and look at. So your abbot or your spiritual director would be the person that you would turn to. So it's very important that they're actually good people themselves. Abbots were usually chosen by election for monks. So the monks would say, yeah, you know, we'll have this person in place, and they, you know, we're going to put them in place in part because we realize we need somebody to help us out. God through prayer, Cassian talks about, the action of prayer is supposed to be a sort of back and forth between the person and God. So that's Cassian's advice. And what we've seen now is we have, just to sort of wrap this up, we have these quite varied perspectives on anger, ranging from Cassian, zero tolerance kind of guy, right? Anger's never good. All the way to people like Lactantius saying, look, you know, God wouldn't really be God if he didn't feel anger, at least, you know, in some respect, not just, you know, act in ways that we can, you know, say are like anger in humans, but God, he thinks God actually feels anger. So we have a huge gamut. Early Christian thought is pretty diverse in this respect. But you notice there are some common elements. Nobody's going to say anger is a good thing, do as much of it as you like. You know? They all think that anger is a problem. They all meditate on the same scripture passages. What does this passage mean about he who gets angry, you know, with his brother is liable to the judgment? What's being gotten at there? So there are certain touch stones that they keep coming back to over and over again. And these guys are going to influence each other, and they're also going to influence later Christian writers thinking about this. Yeah?
Did any of them ever touch on the issue that anger is not good for your health?
Oh, in the writings of them that I've read, no.
No?
Now, I'm not a patristic scholar, so my reading in these guys is largely motivated by my interest in other people. Like, I read John Cassian because I wanted to know more about St. Anselm. Cassian, with him, I have read all of that he has because it's just three books that we possess. Augustine, you know, there's a lot that Augustine wrote, and Chrysostom and people like that. I don't know about them talking very much about the effect on the body. Where they do talk about it would be like So Chrysostom, when he's talking about look at how anger appears, he uses some of the same discussions that Seneca used, because he would have read Seneca. Like, you know, if you could put a mirror in front of me, I could see how my face is all distorted. But they're not talking about, like, anger being bad for your heart or things like that.
No. I just thought maybe they might have intuited that. I don't know.
That it's bad for our physical frame?
Yeah.
Yeah,
well,
it would...
They weren't that advanced yet.
Intuition, I thought, maybe. Well, that's why I thought I'd ask.
It would depend on how much they stressed things like anger's role in inflaming the liver. I mean, the ancient Greeks tended to think about anger, the ancient Greek culture that they're inheriting. There was the view of anger as like a boiling around the heart that Aristotle had and a lot of people picked up on. And then there is the association with the liver. And so too much of it could imbalance things. There were doctors who looked at, you know, the four humors and stuff like that. I mean, all of this medicine is, from a present perspective, not very reliable. We've gotten way past it, but they were thinking of it in terms of physical disease. But they tended to think of it more in terms of mental disease.
Like spiritual.
Yeah, problem with the soul.
I wonder what they'd think about if they could read Facebook comments today.
Well, it depends on whose Facebook they're reading, I suppose, doesn't it? If they're reading, you know, some people who only have a few friends and they don't get into controversies with them, maybe they'd think Facebook would be pretty good. But if they read some of the things that I'm sure all of us have seen on Facebook, these horrible discussions that generate into, you know, like swearing matches.
Yeah, like go out and shoot yourself.
Oh,
I got one of those.
Yeah, people say horrible things to each other. Twitter is even worse, you know. Twitter is like particularly known for rudeness.
I was told I was, she has dementia, you know.
You were told that?
Yeah, well, I had a positive on President Obama, and I had all the haters all over me. Over 5,000 likes.
Yeah.
It was incredible.
I've got a friend who, he's pretty far on the left, and so he's been a diehard supporter of Bernie Sanders, and he is like a lightning rod for abusive comments.
Oh, yeah.
He also has, like, gained a lot of friends in the process, too. So it's not quite so bad now. But at the beginning, people would just say horrible things. And, you know, I mean, you can, like, not like Bernie Sanders and not like what he stands for. But you don't have to, like, you know, say that somebody is just totally stupid or...
Oh, yeah. All of this is in Facebook, everything they're talking about.
This is a good point to make a good place to make a particular point. We often think of it like, you know, we've got philosophical and religious is just purely private and all that. None of these people saw religion that way. They saw one of the reasons why they call what they do Christian philosophy is they see it as in continuity with, but better than what the pagan philosophers are offering. So they're doing a lot of the same stuff. They're trying, because philosophy was understood not just as an academic discipline. It was a way of living, you know. So,
you know, I was just thinking that.
Yeah.
The countries that are doing the most for people today are mostly the Scandinavian countries, right? Weren't they the pagans? Weren't they the ones who were
originally
barbarians and stuff way back and everything like that?
Yeah, but they weren't very good for the people living there at that time.
No, but I mean
you
didn't want to
be a thrall, you know.
Are really doing the most for humankind in the way they treat their citizens.
But
truly.
That sounds like a way oversimplification.
Come out of their pagan past, though. I mean, they were Christians.
No, but they, you know, this to me, these religions with one particular god seem to be the ones that we have seen in the past also, who have done some very awful things.
Well,
whether it be Christian disemboweling,
pagans
or Muslims beheading, or whatever.
You know, if you want to see horrific stuff, look at some of the sacrifices that took place with Aztec religion and the cycle that they got into. They felt like they had to do more and more and more. I mean, we can play the Christian, we can do the monotheistic versus polytheistic numbers game all you like, but nobody comes out well when we do that. The problem is that a lot of the those sort of developments, you'll see some of the people at the very same time within that religion saying, you guys are going off. This isn't what you're supposed to be doing. You know, for every Galileo, there's a Pascal saying, this is not what we're supposed to be doing. You know, so I don't see that as a very useful mode of comparison. I mean,
hadn't thought about it. It's just hit me just a bit when we're thinking about.
It's good to recognize that within any given system like this, like a belief system, there's incredible diversity within it. There are moments where they're trying to like rein in all the diversity of thought and reduce it to a very stilted orthodoxy. Like, you know, with the Catholic Church, the anti-modernism, the requiring all the priests to take this oath against modernism, that was not a good time. That was gotten rid of in Vatican II, you know, the opening that took place there. And we can find this for a lot of different communities. I don't know if that has too much to do with anger.
I just wondered if you could clarify something for me about John Cassian. You mentioned the three parts, I guess, of anger, thumos, orge, and menos, but I didn't quite understand the difference. If you just had like a brief definition of each of those as relating to anger.
These are ways anger is shapes it takes. Mm-hmm. So they're not parts, they're modes. Some people are angry in the sense of like they just kind of hold it in and they don't express it, and they're liable to say passive aggressiveness. Other people are getting angry all the time. We saw this with like Aristotle too, right? You know, there's different ways of going wrong with anger. Some people just will never be reconciled. They're always going to be holding grudges forever. He divides it into these three, and he divides it along linguistic lines. This is kind of a popular way to try to make sense of it. Because, you know, when we talk about anger, we have to acknowledge that we're dealing with different ways it manifests itself. My anger may not manifest itself the same way as yours. So we need sort of anger itself, and then we need categories. So if I'm doing anger management, I need to learn whether I'm a grudge holder, for example. He's associating with this Greek terminology, I think, because that's what a lot of people did at the time. I don't know that it's particularly. I don't know that it's fine enough of an analysis for us, but the monks certainly seem to think it was useful, you know. I mean, I suppose it could be useful if, like, I'm, you know, let's say you're a hothead and you quickly fly off the handle and get angry at all sorts of things, and I'm less like that, but I'm more of a grudge holder. I just, you know, keep my anger for a long time. And so you're a spiritual director, and we get into a big argument with each other, and you're reconciling us. It might be useful for you to say, look, you have orge, you have this anger that, you know, blazes up and then can go away. But that guy over there, he has menace, and it's not quite the same. You know, we're not all on the same page. We don't have the same makeup. So, you know, you over here need to focus on you know, rooting out your anger and forgiving your sister. She needs to focus more on, you know, learning not to fly off the handle, you know, so quickly. Let alone getting angry at my anger, you know, that you get angry at me because I keep holding the grudge or something like that, you know. It could be useful for that sort of classification, I think, but,
yeah.
I mean, other schemas could be useful,
too. The thing is
too.
Not, first of all, you cannot deny a person's having anger. You can't deny it, but you can, to deny it is not going to work.
Do you mean deny it?
But
like
you
in the
can
sense...
understand it like you're saying.
Do you mean
like by saying no anger at all is good?
Okay.
Is that's what I mean? I mean you have
Cassian,
to look at it and then evaluate it.
I really like Cassian for a lot of things, but I find and I think a lot of other people, even in his own tradition, have found this, like, no anger whatsoever pretty tough.
Yeah. It's not normal.
Well, he wants, the monks want to try to work towards a state in which, you know, we're essentially, like, towards the end, like, angelic beings. Doesn't usually happen. I mean, all you got to do is spend some time reading monastic histories and find out how these monks would fight with each other, and usually often about petty things, to see that monastic life wasn't this wonderful, I'm just going to enter the monastery and everything's going to be okay. It's more like, I'm going to enter the monastery and now the real work begins, you know?
Yeah.
Even with Cassian, though, I mean, he's describing all these different ways in which people get angry with each other in the monastery. He says, here's a really good quote. He says, it's not going to do you any good to go into the desert and solitude if you bring your anger with you. Because now you got away from the city and you got away from all your neighbors that you're getting ticked off at all the time. But now you're going to get angry at the stones, at your pen, at the wind, at the sun.
Bird.
Yeah, exactly. So
you have to resolve it. You have to make an effort to resolve it.
Yeah, I guess the question that we're dealing with Cassian is, does resolving it means getting rid of anger altogether? I don't think Augustine or Lactantius or Chrysostom are saying that it is. I think Cassian is.
I just want, talking about that, it seems to me that some anger is actually our way of telling the truth.
Oh.
But in our society, in our society, we can't always tell each other the truth.
Yeah.
And then it'll come out blurted in anger.
Yeah.
If one could separate it, if we had a way of letting the truth out.
Yeah.
I don't know about any of you, have you ever blurted out the truth?
I have. I have a lot.
And also, maybe it's a way of being heard. Someone won't necessarily hear you when you say the truth unless you
do so with anger.
So, for instance, if you had said to that guy slightly different words of, if you want to be treated like an asshole, keep acting as an asshole.
That was what said to me.
Oh, he said okay. Then if it had been said quite quietly with different words, that would have been a true statement, right? About how they felt at that time.
Yeah.
It's the emotion of the anger, I think, which is the problem that we're talking about here.
I wouldn't have listened to him, though, if he hadn't said it in a way that...
That's right.
You know, I needed a good... there was something wrong with me at that time.
So you actually react better to the anger.
Well,
because I didn't
less now, you know. But
yeah.
Well, when you're younger, you
don't
react
too well to anger. What about you guys?
No,
I don't know.
No.
I mean, I think a lot of kids probably get yelled at a lot more than they should.
But I
sure.
Stuff from now.